praises. We come, Lord, with thanksgiving. We come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh Lord, we worship thee. We elevate thy name. We glorify thee. For thou art the only God, the only true and living God. We come in the pardoning merits of the Lord Jesus Christ to worship the triune God. O Lord, we humble ourselves before thee. We speak to thee not from a distance, not like the trembling Israel of old at Mount Sinai. O Lord, we come as children, a child comes to his Father, our Heavenly Father. O Lord, we pray that thou will give us that boldness. We know we wouldn't come if we have not bidden to do so. So we come before thy heavenly throne of grace. O Lord, we are so ashamed. How did we dare to offend thee in the past, even today? How did we dare to reject thee, Lord? We are ashamed of these things, and we ask, Lord, that in thy mercy, thou wilt visit us in this place of worship, in this house of prayer. O Lord, we pray that thou wilt seal home that irreversible charter of forgiveness into our lives for all the people who have trusted in the merits of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. O Lord, we thank thee that we can come. We have been given that great promise that if we confess our sins, thou art righteous God, thou art a faithful God to forgive us, but also to purify us from all iniquity. So Lord, we plead and cry that thou wilt visit us and bless us together, Lord. Oh Lord, do not pass any of us. We need thee, Lord. Without thee, we can do nothing. We are so indebted. And we pray that thou wilt lift up our souls in the studies, in the study of thy word. Give us the concentration we need. Oh Lord, we pray that thou wilt give us relief. Thou wilt give us peace of mind. And may that peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Lord, open thy word to our souls. Bless us in this fellowship. Bless all like-minded churches who are gathered together in this time to worship thee and to fellowship with thee and to study thy word. Lord, come and bless us again. We ask all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
First hymn number 204. Hymn number 204. I have found the pearl of greatest price. My heart now sings for joy.
Thank you.
which becomes sound doctrine. That the aged man be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works, in doctrine showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary path may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. Exhort servants to be obedient unto their own masters, and to please them well in all things, not answering again, not purloining, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adore the doctrine of God our Savior in all things. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the gracious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purity unto himself, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise them. Let's sing together our second hymn, hymn number 77, version 1. Hymn number 77, version 1. To God will I direct my prayers, and he will make my needs his care.
Thank you. preach this evening is Pastor Ibrahim Mohammed, our assistant pastor. Please stay if you can for fellowship and refreshments at the close of the meeting. Recordings of this evening's message will be available. Our source of sharp magazine can be obtained, and our bookshop will be open. Other audio and video recordings of recent ministry are available, including from last Sunday with the gospel message from 1 John 5, verse 12, Life in the Son of God. Now this coming Sunday, our teaching service is at 11 in the morning, and the ministry will continue in the Gospel of John. Our evangelistic service is 6:30 in the evening, but the preacher, God willing, will be our pastor, Dr. Peter Masters. Now there's a special notice about forthcoming events. That there's a table by the exit. We'll find information about our fellowship outing on this coming Bank Holiday Monday, and also forms to use if you have not already done so. Please to advise us of your availability for the work parties on the two Saturdays in June and the School of Theology in the first week of July. Now let's again join in prayer together. Our praise and our gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, O Lord, we bow before thee, the sovereign God over all, holy and righteous, just and merciful. O Lord, how we praise thee that we sinners may come before thee as sinners, saved by grace. Those who are accepted into the Loving One, in the Lord Jesus Christ, our dear Saviour, God the Son. O Lord, we praise and thank thee that he died for our sins, he rose for our justification, he stands in heaven for us. O Lord, we marvel afresh at these great truths of salvation. We praise thee and thank thee for how great and how sure is our salvation, for it stands in him, our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. O Lord, we praise thee afresh for so great salvation in him. O Lord, we pray again that we'll receive us in him. Pardon us afresh and bless us as we come before thee. And O Lord, we pray that we might be humbled and we might be exalted by thy mighty grace toward us. O Lord, we give thee our praise and our thanks. And O Lord, we continue to pray for thy blessing upon thy word, how we need the blessing of thy gracious Holy Spirit as thy word is proclaimed. And Lord, tonight we pray, bless and enable thy servant to be with us, we pray, and apply thy words to our hearts and lives. And O Lord, as we gather on Sunday, gracious God, we pray thou wilt bless and strengthen and enable thy servant to be with us in the preaching of thy word. And O Lord, that thou wilt bless thy word as we gather for morning teaching, as we gather in the evening for a proclamation of the gospel of redeeming grace. O Lord, we pray thou wilt bring many into this place and bring in many whom we've invited. Fill this place, we pray, and bless thy people, and bless needy souls under the sound of the gospel. O Lord, we look to thee for thy continued gracious blessing in salvation, opening blind eyes, unstopping deaf ears, softening proud hearts, and bringing sinners to Christ. O Lord, how every sinner needs that sense of need. O Lord, we pray, grant this Lord's Day to many that sense of need to be saved and crying out to our Lord Jesus Christ for mercy. And O Lord, bringing, we pray, many to Sunday school and Bible class, how we thank thee for the many children and young people, both here and at the missions, who gather together in these days. O Lord, how much we see this is thy doing, and we pray thou wilt bless, grant safety in the transportation, bring many in. Bless all who teach and lead. And O Lord, we pray, bless the children, bless the young people, and draw them aside as they are just for an hour from this world so full of the hell-driven programming of this world against thee. O Lord, bless them, we pray, with thy truth, and cause eyes to be opened to the gracious truth of the gospel. And O Lord, we thank thee for thy word that goes out more widely by website and webcast and through the television program. And O Lord, we pray thou wilt continue to bless these means. And we will remember, Lord, the simultaneous interpretation into into languages and into death, O Lord, we pray that thou will bless all those who labour in this work and grant a true representation of the message, that many, many more may be blessed through the ministry of thy word. O Lord, as we think of forthcoming activities, how we thank and praise thee for our fellowship together in this place. Ever knit us together, we pray, in the bonds of love. And O Lord, receive our service, how we praise and thank thee for service here in this passing world for the King of Kings. And O Lord, we pray, thou wilt bless us in all we seek to do for thee. And we think particularly of our forthcoming school of theology. And O Lord, we pray that thou wilt bring many into this place. And by the preparation and enabling of the speakers, thou wilt grant us a mighty blessing, that much good may be done, our gracious God, to thy people, and in the work of thy dear kingdom. And, O Lord, we pray as a fellowship for those who are unwell in body and mind in our midst, and those who are frail. Pray, Lord, that thou wilt be pleased to be near them and bless them. Praise them up if it please thee. And, O Lord, as we seek to serve thee in this city, let us know how many practical needs we have as individuals and as a church gathered here. And, O Lord, we look to thee that we may continue to prove thee in prayer as our provider, as we seek to serve thee in the things that thou hast given us to do. And, O Lord, how we need thy blessing upon our witness. Be with us, we pray, as individuals in all our opportunities. Go with us as we go forth from this place to witness in the streets. O Lord, we look to thee and we pray that thou wilt have mercy upon many, and bring many in by these means. And, O Lord, we pray for all thy people in these difficult days, those whom we support overseas, and even, O Lord, those many, many of thy people who suffer persecution and deprivation, imprisonment, O Lord, such suffering for the name of Christ, and even in such circumstances, as it has been in times gone by, may it be in these days, that in darkness there may be light. In such circumstances it may be proved over and again that the word is not bound, and many souls may be touched even by the witness of thy dear people who suffer for the Saviour. O Lord, we look to thee in all these things. We give thee our thanksgiving for thy great goodness to us, and pray thou wilt hear us in the name of our dear Saviour and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
verse 1. Titus chapter 2, verse 1. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged man be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. So we come again to this wonderful letter. It is a short letter. It deals with the church order, but it deals also with conduct, practical theology. This is really what this letter is all about. How do we behave because of what we believe? The way we behave shows also what we believe. So in this section, in chapter 2, Paul is giving us a rich and a large spectrum of life in terms of age, in terms of genders, in terms of unity, in terms of behavior, but in terms also of diversity in the local church. So all these elements and traits appear in the letter. So I start with a question: how do we adorn? How do we show sound doctrine in our lives? How do we adorn the gospel of redeeming grace? So these are really questions that this chapter will also answer. And as you read the chapter, you will see there is no gender confusion. It is very clear for God. There are men and women. There are old men, old women, young men, young women. There are workers, there are servants. So diversity in unity in the local church. But though the principles we are going to speak about are related to the aged, we have to say, and I will do my best to show you that, the principles are applicable to all the church, each one of us. So, it's a bit an unusual Bible study just to focus on a particular age in the church, but you will see it is applicable to all of us, young, old, men, women, every one of us. So let's start by looking at verse 1. And you will see that Paul begins this chapter by speaking first of all to Titus. Because remember, Titus is the prototype. Titus is the pattern. So the pastor, the elder, or the elders, are to be a pattern to the believers in the local church. And that's the harmony. Really, you find that unity and harmony because the head is well, the body also will be well. When one member of your body, even our physical body, is not well, the whole body feels it. So in the same way, when all the members of the local church are healthy, the church is healthy. When one member, do you know, and we have to realize that before even I come to explain more, when one of us is living a disorderly life, a life that is unpleasing to the Lord, you know it affects the whole church. And it has happened in so many churches where one person in the church, if I could give even the example of in the Old Testament, when the people of God had to enter in the city of Ai, they couldn't overtake the city because there was someone, Achan, he misbehaved. And he did things that God forbade them to do. So don't think your sin or my sin is just personal. It affects and it infects the whole church. And it deprives the church from its instrumentality. Don't let any disorder or any misbehavior or misconduct to deprive the local church from the blessings the Lord has wants to bestow upon the church. So we come and we see Titus is the pattern. And Paul speaks to him in verse 1, but speak thou
the things. And you can see, I'm sure, again, the sharp contrast. There is a difference between what Titus is going to teach. And you remember our previous Bible study from chapter 1, verse 16, the poisonous, the polluted, and deadly poison of false teachers. And the words there are really, as I said, harsh and so extreme, abominable, disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate, in verse 16 of chapter 1. But now you can see Titus is different. He is completely different. This man is not the poisonous false teaching, but sound doctrine. And as I kept repeating to you, the word sound means healthy. The word sound means correct. The word sound means righteous. The word sound means pure. The word sound means solid, well-rooted. That's really the meaning of the word sound. And the word doctrine, again, is the word teaching. That's the meaning. Teaching of what? Teaching the whole counsel of God. That's why, as preachers, we don't just pick and choose what we want. Oh, these are our favorite verses, and we know we can easily speak on them, and they will flatter people, they will bring comfort to people. Sometimes we have to say things that are hard, not because we want to be hard, but because this is the word of God. And that is why expository teaching and preaching is so relevant, because then the preacher has just to come to the text and explain to you what is in the text without inventing anything. We do not invent anything. We do not improve the word of God. We do not add to it. We have just to explain it and bring applications to what it says, because God has already inspired it. So Titus, you see the word there? But speak. It's the word like chat. Speak about it, proclaim it, teach it, exhort the believers. All these words could really explain the word speak there. Don't hide it, don't be shy, don't shy away from it. And sometimes we have to repeat to you the things you already know. And many times it humbles me. After a Bible study or a sermon, a believer comes to me and he says, thank you for the reminder. It's just a reminder. And most of what we are telling you, that's why I said we do not innovate. We are just reminding you our duties, our obligations. So a pastor, a preacher is what? He is a teacher, he is an instructor, but he is also somebody who exhorts. He is an exhorter. And sometimes he has to rebuke. Why? Look at the book ends of this chapter, please. Just for your mind. Look at how verse 1 starts and the last verse of the chapter. You will see how he's repeating the same things in one way. And in verse 1, Paul says, but speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. Look, verse 9. He will say, exhort servants to be obedient unto their own masters. And verse 15, three commands there. Three injunctions, imperatives. Not something optional. They are commands which are to be obeyed by every preacher. And in verse 15, these things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise you. Let no one look you down when you speak on these things, because they are biblical, and you are only passing the message with its applications to help believers to remember their obligations and their duties. So this is so helpful to us. And the things what Paul is going to speak about in this chapter are really areas in our lives where, please, my dear brothers and sisters, these are areas where you and me, we need to be watchful. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter if you are a man or a woman, a child or an old person. These are areas Paul is going to say we need to be watchful. I didn't give you my title from the beginning, not to put you off, because you will say, oh, this is not about me. So my title is, very simple. And it comes from verse 2. And Paul says there that the aged men, and in verse 3, the aged women. So aged godly men and women. That's my title. But I'm not pleased with the title. I'm inclined to change it. Be prepared to be bold. If that's better, you choose. So be prepared to age well also. But we are speaking about believers, and this is wonderful. You are a saved old man, you are a saved senior, you are a saved aged person, you are a saved young person. All what we are going to say tonight is really, God loves us so much that He even planned and helped us to know how to become old. I know we live in a society now when nobody likes to be seen as old. Even the old senior say to him, "You are aged." No, don't women. The other day we were in a place where at least three or four women, they were telling us their age, and somebody said, they said it all. What? Because nobody wants to get old nowadays. But you see, Bible says in Proverbs, old age is a crown of glory. We have so much. Oh, I wish we can come near all our seniors all the time to sit at their feet and to learn from them, to learn from their experience, to learn from their piety and godliness, to learn from them, even from their afflictions and persecutions. So this is what really Paul is going to speak about. And I will limit myself to the three first verses, because as time goes, you will see this chapter can be easily divided. Very easy. Verse 1 to 3, Paul is speaking about aged men and women. Verse 4 to 8, he's going to speak about young women and young men. So we will come to that in a future study. Then from verse 9 to 10, he will speak to servants, those who are employees, who hard work in the church, but also outside the church in the secular world. Then from verse 11 to verse 14, he's going to define grace. Because of grace, because of some teaching, some doctrine, here are the virtues which should be adored by every believer. So you can see this is so orderly and so helpful when you look at it. So Paul says to Titus, speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged man be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. So after dealing with the church as a whole in chapter 1, now Paul comes to individuals in the church, the aged, the young, the workers. But please, there are six groups. He's given to us six groups there. But every group is really related to us. You will see the virtues, the behavior, the demeanor. These are things that are applicable to your life and to my life, even right now. So God is preparing us as we decay, the body decays. So how should we handle the matter? Should we lash out? Or we should be firm, we should be patient, we should be cool people, if that's the word. How should we behave? So Paul speaks first of all to the aged men. So I will take the man first, the aged man in verse 2. But before I explain the virtues, his the character traits he's calling aged men to be, may I make some applications even before I mention those things. The first thing is that sin makes no respect of age. That's a reality. Sin makes no respect of gender. It makes no respect of color. It makes no respect of persons. Which means the seniors, the older men, the older women are to conduct themselves and act according to their age. They have to motivate the young ones, and they have to adorn these virtues as an example to the younger generation. My dear brothers and sisters, in the Church of Jesus Christ, there shouldn't be generational conflicts. There should be complementarity. We need the seniors, the aged, the young men need the aged need the young men. And young men. That's really what the Word of God teaches us. We need one another. Every member of the body is important and functions together. So the older ones, the aged, are to function as fathers, spiritual fathers, which means young and old, we have to be soul winners. They have to be fathers to souls, but they have to be fatherly or motherly to believers. Again, you can see the harmony in the local church. Fathers, in 1 John, John speaks about fathers, he speaks about little children and so on. This is about, it's still in relation to the age. But you can be a spiritual father also to someone by being instrumental in his conversion. But once the person is converted, you are a fatherly person to him. So, first application we already made is that sin has no respect for age. Second, you have to be fatherly and a father. But third, age doesn't mean spiritual maturity. It's not because somebody has 30, 40, 50 years in the Lord, walking with the Lord, that it means he is mature. But the opposite is also true. It's not because somebody is young, it means he's not mature. So age is not a guarantee for maturity, but youth also is not a defect of immaturity. You may meet somebody, and I hope nobody is in that case in the church here, you may meet somebody 20 years, 30 years being a Christian, you ask him, do you know the doctrines of faith? Do you know the doctrines of grace? Do you know what is election? Do you know what is repentance? Do you know what is regeneration? Oh, what's that? Do you know what the Bible says about witnessing to non-believers? Do you know what the Bible says about marriage? So I'm pointing at these things just to say we can be for many years in the faith, but we are spiritual dwarfs. And that is a big danger. But enough maybe with the negative. I hope it's not negative. But you can be young and be a spiritual giant. I believe so. You yield your life to the Lord. You walk with the Lord. You read your Bible daily. You pray daily. You witness daily. You seek for fellowship daily. You are where the people of God are daily. You strive for discipline. You strive for holiness. You strive for obedience. Bible says you will grow spiritually. It doesn't matter how old you are. Now, we come to the aged man, first man, the aged man, and Paul is going to give us four things. And I will make them very simple, and later I will do the balance, the equilibrium, with good women, and he will give also four things in relation to the aged women. But please, don't misunderstand me. Everything said about the old man and the old women is said exactly to the young men and to the young women. The first thing, let's look at it together. So first thing, Paul says that the aged men be sober. This is the favorite word of Paul. Sober, to be sober. So the meaning there is very simple. To be sober means to be self-controlled, not self-absorbed. You know, as age comes and goes, people self-exalt themselves. I often say young people are always thinking about the future. The older ones are always taking us to the past. How the past was so nice, so wonderful, or everything was so beautiful. They don't mention the gloomy part, but everything was not nice in the past also. Bible speak about evil days. So there are no such thing really as wonderful past days. It's all evil. So sober means to be venerable, to be dignified, balanced, respected, respectable, and respectful. And I can tell you, I have met aged men who do not deserve any respect because of the way they behave in churches. But the godly man, the godly aged man, is to be sober, respected, respectable, and respectful. Not grumpy, not stubborn, not insensitive or irritable, easily irritated. As you know, age is never a license. Be sober, not somber. Sobriety is not soberness. That's some people, they confuse that because they have hard face and I don't smile at all. It means I'm so spiritual. But that's not the meaning. Don't be gloomy. Young and old, we have given life and joy by the Lord Jesus Christ. And just to show you that this is not only to the aged men, it is for all of us. Please turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 6. And this is the only verse I promise to show you that it is applicable to all of us. All of us. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 6. And Paul says that, therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. You see, to the whole church, all believers. So the sobriety is not just to the old man. And you will see later, he will say the same to aged women. He will say the same to young men. He will say the same to the young women. So the same. We are all on this, under the same rule, under the same command from the Word of God. So that's the first thing. Eight men are to be sober. Can I give you an example of somebody who lashed out in his old age? Isaac. Isaac, he didn't exercise sobriety. He wanted a meal. You know, you remember how he wanted his sons, Esau and Isaac, and that we know the problem that brought after. But he lacked sobriety. But we have Simon, the old Simon, the aged Simon in the New Testament, in Luke chapter 2. This is a good example of a sober believer. In his old age, he was sound in mind, he was sound in the heart, and he saw the baby, the child, the Lord Jesus Christ, and he remembered the great testimony he gave about the Lord Jesus Christ. And he even said, now Lord, you can take me, I have seen the Lord. What has been promised for so long, now I see it with my own eyes. But the second thing about the aged man is not only to be sober, but to be grave. To be grave. And the word here means to be dignified. Dignified. Not to be silly or flabby, that's the meaning also. And it means to be serious. But grave doesn't mean uncheerful. Grave doesn't mean the person doesn't have a sense of humor, but nowhere to place your humor. That's the wisdom. Wisdom. That's really wisdom. Some people, they lash out their humor everywhere and anywhere without any second thought. But a grave, aged man is somebody who is grave. He's serious, not trivial. He doesn't tell jokes with vulgar language. And by his behavior, he wins people's esteem. The third one, temperate. That's another word Paul favors so much. It means to have a right mind. And if I may read for you, Proverbs 25, verse 28. And it is said that he that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls. A man or a woman who is not temperate, who doesn't have right mind, is like a city without walls. In the past, cities, walls protect a city. So if you are not right in your mind, it means an avalanche. Everything has access to your mind. That's why we have to protect our mind. My dear brothers and sisters, that's why, if I may speak to the younger ones, what you put in your ears, when you have that music in your ears, it goes to the mind. Don't think just it titillates your flesh. It goes to your mind. And what fills your mind goes to your heart, because the mind is the palace of faith, while the heart is the seat of emotions. And what comes when your mind is informed with evil things, they inform your heart, and you act upon what your heart is telling you. So that's why what we read, what we watch, what we listen to is so important. So be sober, be grave, be sound in mind, temperate. It means when we age, it's easy for us to get irritated and to complain. And that shouldn't be the case. An old person should be rational and reasonable. He has to be safe. He has to be stable, he has to be calm, and he has to be collected. That's very important on everyone, for everyone. And the fourth one, given here, that the aged man be sober, grave, temperate. He put the triad, faith, love. He has patience here, but please, you can even read patience with hope, by hope. So the triad, which is so necessary for the believer. Sound, healthy, in the faith. Actually, in the Greek, there is the definite article in the passage here, verse 2. Be sober, brave, temperate, sound in the faith. Which means sound in the whole teaching of the Word of God, sound in what God has passed on to his prophets in the Old Testament, through the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament, and through the apostles also in the New Testament. So, sound in the faith, healthy in love. So you can see, love is not just a feeling. Some people say, love at first sight, you better wear better glasses. It doesn't work that way. So love is not an emotion. Love is a duty. Love is a choice. Love is a command, and you have to work at it. You work at it. You protect love. Husbands and wives, and so on. Protect young men courting. Protect it. It doesn't just come down from thin air. You have, as like a candle, you have to protect it and rekindle it when it's growing cold. So they have to be sound in the faith, but also in love and patience. And I'm sure you know, when we become older and older, we become impatient. We want those things to be done. Our whole world now is impatient. Microwave Christianity. Have it quickly, instantaneously. That's all. God, give it to me and right now. But you cannot command God. He's sovereign. He has his time. He promised to answer our prayers, but he will do it in his time, not according to our whims. And remember, God gives us what we need, not what we want. Please thank God that he doesn't answer all your prayers. Otherwise, you will be in trouble for a long time. So, to be sober, to be grave, to be temperate, in right in the mind, sound in the faith, sound in love, and sound in patience. Excel in faith, excel in love, excel in hope. Faith on the Lord Jesus Christ, love for God and patience in living. Cope well with life when you get old. I'm speaking to you because today I was at the care home. So I interacted with the seniors, and it is a humbling experience. Some of them do not cope well with life. But you know what? You will see even there the difference between believers and non-believers, the way they cope with life. Please allow me this digression. You go to the care homes, you will see the people who stare like this were people who spent their life watching TV. But others who listen and sing the hymns, read the Word of God, were people who were reading. That's the big difference. So prepare yourself. Instead of staring to emptiness, you stare at the Word of God. You stare at the hymns. You want to listen not to what is said on the TV, bombarding you day after day. It's all the time in some care homes, all the time it's on, non-stop. It was a digression. So come back to our text, Titus chapter 2. That the eight men be sober, brave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, love, and in patience. So don't lose your capacity to be moved about the things of God. We cannot begin too soon to aim at a life like the life described to us here. So now I come to the age women. Four things also said about them there in verse 3. The aged women likewise. You see, all the things the aged men are to do, in the same manner, the aged women are to be sober, they are to be grave, they are to be temperate, they are to be sound in faith, in love, and in patience. So all is applicable to them also. But Paul adds something more unto them, which is applicable to all of us again. So we come to that, and I'm sure you will see the difference. Now Paul says, likewise, the eight women. There is a contrast. He's drawing also a contrast between Christian aged women and the worldly aged women. That is, the worldly aged women are walking according to the spirit of the world, but the aged believing women are walking according to the spirit of God. An abyssal difference between the two. So what is expected from them? They have to be reverential in their life. They flourish in age, but also in character. And the first thing Paul speaks about in that verse, to the aged women, likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. Sober and sound. You can replace the word. You can put the word there. They must be sober and they must be sound. They have to have a priestly life, a devoted life, a worshiping life, like Anne again in Luke chapter 2. She was day and night serving the Lord in the temple. So that's a good example of a godly woman who, even late age, she was still sound, she was still living a holy life. After she has experienced 7 years of marriage, her husband died, and after that she gave herself to serving the Lord. So there is no spiritual retirement for believers. You may retire from your secular job, but God has a retirement program for you and me to serve Him. So, and their demeanor must be dignified. Aged women, the demeanor must be dignified as becoming holiness, as it fit holiness. There must be holiness in their life. She is to be pure and free from volatility. Younger women are watching you as you are watching over them. Be an example to them. Now there are two negatives after this, that first one, a holy behavior before God. Now there are two negatives. And the first negative, it says, not false accusers. And the word accuser there, or accusers, is the word diabolos, diabolical. That's really, who wants to be associated with the devil? So, aged women are not to be false accusers, gossipers. This is all of us. And I'm sure you don't need me to tell you, this is the trend of the world. That's how the world functions. Unfortunately, gossip can destroy a church also. So, not to be false accusers, a fault finder. But this is not just women. Men also, all of us, we can find ourselves to be slanderers. A slanderer befriends the devil. You know where the devil is? Where gossip is. That's his home. But as believers, we should speak to edify, not to slander. We should speak, Ephesians 4:15, speak the truth in love and with love. Always, with wholesome words, not to harm. It is not because you know something that you have to spread it. And sometimes please check before you spread anything. I will give you soon a test. Just a test. Before you speak about anything, you have to put a test. And you will save yourself from many, many pains and troubles. So, gossip is never passive. What? Because the person who is listening likes to hear more. Tell me more. Is it so? We ask questions to know more. Why? Behind gossip, there is a form of hatred. There is a form of harm. There is a form of jealousy. Let no one be a gossiper in the Church of Jesus Christ. And talking can increase with age. We know that. So we have to be very careful not to be too verbal. That's a besetting sin in all of us, to be talkative. Replace slander by wholesome, truthful, and honest words. So please, can I give you the test? Before you pass on any information, here is the test. Is it true? Is it helpful? Is it honest? Is it edifying? You can apply Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 there. Is it pure? So that's really the test. And you can also ask, add, is it kind? Or am I trying just to slander, backbeat the other person? Now, the third thing, the negative one, not given to much wine. She shouldn't be slave to wine. She shouldn't drink from the world. Leave even the drink, the liquid. But she shouldn't drink anything, be enslaved of anything from the world. Borrowing anything, self-admiration, self-congratulation, performance. That's to all of us also, not just to the aged women, but all of us. And as you know, with wine comes gossip. And somebody who is given to wine is capable of any sin you can think about. Here is a person, kind person, pious person, godly person. You want him to kill somebody, make him to drink. You want him to commit adultery, make him to drink. You want him to gossip, make him to drink. You want him to tell you secrets, make him to drink. So, aged women are not to be slave to any dissolution, to any wine, to any liquid, to anything from the world, to any substance, and she has to be sound of mind. That's what Origen, this is a church father, he said something really very important. He said, drunkenness is the mother of old vices, but sobriety is the mother of virtues. Now the last one, teachers of good things. Actually the Greek says, it's one word in the Greek, teachers of beautiful things. So instead of being gossipers, false accusers, or given to wine, the positive now. They are to be teachers of good things. But Paul is very precise. He said unto the aged women, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. That verse 4, that they may teach the young women to be sober. We'll come to that in another Bible study, because there are at least 7 threats given to the young women in that passage. But so far, as I close, the aged women are to help the young women as an example. They have to teach them by example, by their words, not to hold a class, a Titus 2 class, because that's a fashion now, but it is by their words and by their conduct. Come in, not informal, because women are not, it is Titus. Titus chapter 2, verse 1. He's the one who should be teaching these things to the whole church. So nobody, aged woman should set a class for herself where she is telling young ladies what to do about their homes. But this is by informal example of words and teaching from the Word of God and experience. So these things are so helpful, I'm sure, assist the younger women in what concerns their homes. Teach them by words and conduct. Marriages are under attack nowadays. So aged women are to help the younger ones. Teach them not to compare themselves. We are very comparative. You see that home, you see this home, but teach the younger ones not to compare, to be themselves. I could have brought to you 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1 to 6, but when we study young women, we have to bring those verses, because the beauty is the internal beauty. Young man, you are looking for a wife, do not look at the external. Look at the character. Look at the internal beauty. Young woman, you are looking for a husband, don't look for his handsomeness, if that's an English word. Don't look for his handsomeness. Don't look for his galanteria manners. Don't look for his, is he godly? What is he talking about all the time? Otherwise, it is a snare. It is a snare. Don't fall into that. So, as I close, age is against all of us. But the Lord is for us. Do you see the contrast? Age is against you, but God is on our side. So, young or old, we can examine ourselves with these things. Sound doctrine is for all. The older generation is to communicate grace to the younger one. And it is also for the younger ones to interact with the older ones. So, aged men, be sound. Believers, all believers, to be sound, to be grave, to be temperate, and to be sound in faith, in love, and in patience. What about aged women? They are to be holy, to live a holy life. They are to live a priestly life dedicated to the Lord. They are not to be false accusers. They are not to be given to any substance. They are not to be given to the spirit of the world. But they have to teach also good things, beautiful things, by example and by experience. So this is how aged, godly men and women are to adorn sound doctrine. May the Lord bless us. Bless you. And close our time together by singing our last hymn, hymn number 467. Hymn number 467. have, O thou who camest from above, the pure celestial fire in part. At home, in the neighborhood. We ask all these blessings in the name of the Lord. Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.